Finally, we conclude our body count of Edward VIII, the Falala of France. Hello and welcome to Body Count, the podcast where we believe history doesn't repeat itself, it rhymes. My co-host to the utmost this week.
Hello, everyone. My name is Bethany Skelton, and I am so excited to finally be finishing up Edward because, girl, he is on my last nerve. Okay, I have had it up to here. And if you could see me, my hand is high, okay? I've had it up to here.
Preach, so, sister.
Girl, and I know you've got more BS for me today, so bring it on, okay?
Oh, gosh, boy,
bring it
on. All right. So, as I said last week, we're done officially with our disclaimers. You know what you're getting yourself into by now. We're kicked back on the couch, about to break down some seriously disturbing history, guys. If we get all of this out of our brains, it alleviates our anxiety just like,
yes,
woo!
Please.
Please, we desperately need it. I mean, where there's a stressor around every corner, every little bit helps.
Amen.
Oh, but this is not your boring history class, and we are also not hardcore history. We're not Dan Garland. So we're going to have some laughs as we talk about some pretty serious subjects. And that's because we just don't take ourselves too seriously.
Never.
Now, God knows, and we don't deserve to. All right. So, 24-hour news cycle, guys. We don't have time to process an event anymore before they rip the next Band-Aid off, hit us with the next body count. So we're here today to slow it down, examine events that shape the world we live in, and hopefully correlate them with current events that, you know, you've got all of 10 seconds to process these days. So if you're looking for that Hoover-esque, just the facts, ma'am, history, and on occasion true crime where it's applicable, podcasts, glad you stopped by. We're not going to be for you. But if you want to be entertained, verse preached at, we have a lot to get to today. But first, as always, our housekeeping. If you like the show, please, please subscribe, rate, and review wherever you listen to podcasts, guys. It's not for our ego, but we certainly appreciate those 5 stars. If you hate it, please just don't say anything at all. Yeah. We'd appreciate that. Move on. if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all. Again, it's really not for our egos. I mean, but we very much approve. If anybody likes it, it makes us feel very, very good. But it does help us when we're moving up the charts, and it helps us on the business end of things. Really, really does. Also, please, please, please go find and follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Now, our sources to today, they're going to be the same as last week. And you will remember that there are a lot of them.
Yes.
But because we do this right, we'll review them once more. I mean, So I combed info from the Nazi archives at Bonn. Declassified American documents, you know, some 227 pages of the bitches. I swear, like 5 documentaries made at various periods in history. Our previous source, 17 Carnations, The Royals, The Nazis, and The Biggest Cover-Up in History by Andrew Morton. And we are adding all the books and interviews ever done by Professor Jonathan Petropoulos. Because he is the end-all, be-all on the authoritarian kind of Nazi English bullshit, if you will. So, go check all of that out on Amazon, but especially Morton's book, because again, without him, we wouldn't have had any place to start with it. So, we have a ton of material. One more week, guys, just one more. Stick with us, because this is where it gets really, really juicy. So we're going to jump in. We're going to continue with Edward and Wallace's wacky, highly offensive, sig-heiling, goose-stepping adventures. So, Bethany, you buckle up that seatbelt. You get
oh,
in.
Girl.
You locked
I am
in.
Locked.
You ready to go?
I'm locked, loaded, strapped with every harness possible because you left me hanging last week with Edward coming back from a trip to Germany, being offered a delicious treason cake and power sprinkles all over it by Hitler. So, I mean, if he gets his cake and gets to eat it too, so do I. So I'm ready to have my cake and eat it too. So tell me. Tell me all about it.
Here we go. Let's get down to the truth. Edward, and I will believe this to my dying day that this is true. And again, theoretical body count, was aware of a plan to use him as the center of a peace movement. Just a peace on Hitler's terms kind of plan. So, Badeau had certainly broached the idea with his bestie Edward before. In Paris, a cable exists between Badeau and Vinaigrette testifying to the truth of this and reads as follows. Your friend Windsor made an exceptionally sympathetic impression, delighted to cooperate, but we must be exceedingly careful. We'll submit plan later. So here they are already talking about Edward and some kind of plan we're not exactly sure of in concert with the Nazis. So let's go ahead and start hashing out what it is we're talking about here. While in Germany, Edward went to visit Rudolf Hess at his home because, you know, everyone just came around to Hitler's right-hand man's house for cake all the time, right? I mean, it's just what you do when in Rome. So they were definitely there as their names are in the visitor's log, signed Edward and Wallace, Duke and Duchess of Windsor. Now, according to Hess's son, Wolf Rüdiger Hess, to my knowledge, my father met the Duke and Duchess two times, one time officially in Munich, and then it was a second time when he had a private invitation at my father's home in Munich. My mother told me that they went to the cellar, and when they came back, they were both very excited. And my mother took from this that they understood themselves quite well in discussing politics. For example, both were anti-communists to mention one thing. The Duke of Windsor definitely was an imperialist talking about the British Empire. And he saw that the question was not any more the balance of power in Europe. It was a question of balance of power in the world, which Churchill obviously didn't understand. End quote. And again, this is kind of why this is theoretical. I'm putting this together from a lot of hearsay. So what the hell are we talking about exactly? Mm-hmm. What negotiated peace were Hess and Edward hot-gossing over? Well, it was based on the New World Order. Oh, God. And you know the story is going to start to get really crazy when you hear new anything, insert word here, order, you know? But what the hell did that even mean? Like, what were they hashing out? Basically this, that the Nazis would have free reign in Europe and Britain could keep her current empire. Hess even allegedly offered Edward German troop assistance to lay down the law on the colonies if it fucking came to that. Lovely.
Wow.
Wonderful. But what would Edward get out of all of this? Oh, I don't know. How about a return to the throne? So let's continue in the words of Wolf Hess, son of Rudolf Hess. In my father or Hitler's view, I think if they would have agreement, now he's talking about agreement between Britain and Germany. And remember, this is a German guy trying to put this into English. So in this case, he's not a native speaker. So part of the agreement would have been that the Duke of Windsor, Edward, would have been reinstalled as King Edward VIII because he had the same views, same political views regarding the world. And he means in this case, his father, Rudolf Hess, and Hitler. Basically, Edward gets his narrow ass back on the English throne as Hitler's best little puppet king. That, dear friends, is treason in my mind. And this is why 'tis the treason or season for some treason. What do you think, Bethany?
La 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 la. Absolutely. Holy smokes. Like, I'm trying to, like, seriously process everything you've just said. Like, it's absolutely insane. So basically, like, they offer, like, hey, we're going to take over, but you get to keep all, every, nothing changes, and you get to be king again. That's like, we're going to make a cake that is going to have sprinkles and candles on it.
That's exactly right. And not only that, but the king he's talking about supplanting is his own brother.
Yeah, that he gave up in the first place.
Mm-hmm. So, woo, if that wasn't bad enough, let's continue on with our little visit to Germany. Oh, this German visit. I've got to, like, prep myself for what's coming. So, Edward first goes to check out the SS training school at Crossensee, which that place has to be both the nerdiest and scariest shithole of all time, right? Like, remember, guys, give nerds their credit, because if we don't, they get angry, they band together, and they start LARPing D&D meets Risk, and the world gets Nazis. That's how this happens. So, like, be nice to a nerd you know today. Like, go touch one. Hug one.
Hugging one. Well, ask first. But some nerds don't like to be hugged.
Get consent. Always get consent.
Yes.
Oh, gosh. God. I have to prep myself for this part. Ready? Okay. Are we ready?
Mm-hmm.
Edward then went to see a concentration camp. Now, the full Holocaust wasn't on yet, but the camps were stuffed full at this time of political prisoners. So basically anyone that disagreed with Nazis, which, why wouldn't you? And no matter what they say, at that time, there were definitely some Jewish prisoners within the camp as well. So let's kick it back to Edward's equerry, Sir Forwood, who, remember, was on this little trip with him.
Mm-hmm.
Behind the scenes, they had already started murdering people. But I think it is true to say, and I say with my hand on my heart, that neither I, myself, or indeed the Duke of Windsor, realized the slaughter that was taking place. He even went to a concentration camp, and there we saw the prisoners. But we never, never realized for a moment that this mass murder was taking place, end quote. Which, I'm about to raise some serious doubts on this big old pile of horse shit. Bethany, you've smelled slaughterhouses and rendering plants. You have to pass like 3,000 of them driving back and forth across the high plains. And I know that I certainly have smelt those things. So, Bethany, think of the smell. Is that in your brain?
Yes.
Okay. Now imagine instead of chickens, pigs, cows. These are humans.
Yeah.
So, okay, remember, Hitler had to knock off, like, all of those political dissenters housed in the camps to make room for those Hitler planned to exterminate once he began his final solution. So, bullshit that no one in that party didn't know. You're exactly right. You would have smelt it. They fucking knew.
They knew. And the fact that he was like, I swear, I put my hand on my heart. Like, okay. That's like, okay, if your hand's on your heart, what's your other hand doing? Got cross fingers behind your back? God.
Oh, my God. I mean, no way you don't smell it. First off, no freaking way you don't smell it. But even let's exclude that fact. Even if they don't quote, no, I'm horrified by the notion that anyone from a free democratic nation was perfectly fine with torturing and imprisoning people in the most inhumane conditions imaginable simply because they disagree with Nazi policy. But they saw it, said nothing, and just kept on walking. Therefore, I'm willing to throw a small part of that whole mess at Edward's feet as well. If you felt anything for this little tick turd before, let this now be the point where we all collectively spit on his grave. Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Hockaloogie.
Ah. Like piss on this guy. Anything I felt before him when I read that, I was so angry, guys. Nope, piss on him. There is no excuse. Mm-hmm. If he wasn't already dead, I hope he died. So after this, here's the topper on the cake. After this, they head off to Hitler's precious mountain retreat, the Berghof near Berchtesgaden in the Obersalzberg, to meet the man himself, Adolf Hitler. Mm. And boy, were they stoked about it, Bethany. And you can actually go see those photos on our Instagram. No matter how many times Instagram tries to take it down.
Oh, girl. No. That, when you told me that Instagram tried to take it down, deemed inappropriate, just because you don't like it and it rubs you the wrong way doesn't give you the right to take it down. It's proven fact. You paid for that photo. You have every right to post it.
I have every right to post it. And not only that, we should all feel very uncomfortable that a member of the royal family is all smiles while his wife is getting her hand kissed by fucking Adolf Hitler. We should all have to look at that ugly truth every single day. Ooh. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, Hitler was very happy to welcome them. I mean, after all, Edward had all but gotten down on his hands and knees and blown him. I mean, he was happy to be Hitler's Nazi pawn, you know? And Edward was love pissing off Britain just as much as Hitler was. Mm-hmm. Hitler called Wallace Your Highness, of course he did, and even said of her, she would have made a good queen. Which, again, if we had any lingering doubt about these two people, if Hitler genuinely likes someone, I think that's like the ultimate tell of character right there. How about you, Bethany?
I mean, it's just, when somebody asks you for three references, you know, you really should think about who you put down as a reference. You know, Adolf Hitler is probably not the best choice.
Oh, let's see. Adolf Hitler, Rudolf Hess,
Stalin, Mussolini.
You know what? Himmler is definitely going to be in there. And Goering, you know, those are all real winners that you want on that. Dear God. Is anybody missing from that wonderful list? Unbelievable. The British establishment was speechless. Understandable. So the couple's next stop was supposed to be the United States of America to spread their bullshit message of negotiable peace on Hitler's terms. And let me tell you, Roosevelt stopped that shit right quick. And not just because Roosevelt was immediately in tune with all the dangers that the Nazis represented. Edward had already crossed America once. Now, Secret State Department memo report from the time contained the following tale. George Messerschmitt, in June 1937, was a still young American diplomat in Vienna when he ran into the Windsors at an official state dinner. Now, Messerschmitt spoke to Edward in confidence. I mean, Britain and America were the allies of the Allied following World War I. Why wouldn't he believe anything he said to the former king was safe? Therefore, Messerschmitt tells Edward that a train chock full of illegal cargo of naval armaments from Nazi Germany to Italy had crashed and burned in Austria. Now, this was top secret. Messerschmitt made a number of errors, assuming Edward didn't want the enemy to know, and that Edward was even clever enough to deduce exactly what this information meant. What it meant was that the Americans knew this because they were, one, intercepting, and two, capable of decoding the Italian military ciphers as early as 1937. Edward then goes and immediately tells an Italian diplomat in attendance in the party. And remember, Nazi Germany and Italy were very close. Messerschmitt, poor man, had to immediately report the breach to Roosevelt. But from that point on, Roosevelt was under no illusions about Edward. He saw him for what he was right then and there.
Yeah.
So, let's jump ahead in 1939. It was now clear to those in the know in England that war was inevitable. In an attempt to ensure America remain in neutral isolationism, Edward continued to spread his policy of appeasement, which he had hatched along with his little Nazi besties, by making a friggin' radio broadcast pleading for peace. Of course, the dumb twat didn't understand, and we'll all remember from our Pearl Harbor episodes, that America wasn't jumping in on that war unless we were shoved anyway. In Britain, the broadcast was prohibited, and public opinion overall was already pretty damn anti-Hitler. Everyone was worried about where he would strike next, and despite what the aristocrats may have thought, the public was very disturbed by the emergence of the late 38 rollout of the anti-Jewish program. Edward, therefore, was obviously not considering the wishes of the English people. He was considering the wishes of himself. Britain finally decides to get their shit together and stop giving Hitler Europe, you know, just like all of it. The line in the sand was drawn at Poland, more particularly Danzig. Please, again, go back and look at our Pearl Harbor episodes. Hitler invaded and Britain declares war. George VI gave his brother Edward a lowly military rank in Paris, which, good choice, because Edward and Wallace clearly could not be trusted.
Right. I mean, that was pretty evident.
We're not even to the worst of any of it yet. So, instead of staying in his military quarters like everyone else had to, he popped right into the very best hotels in Paris and wasted no time continuing to chill with his pro-Nazi circle, of which Charles Bedeau was the center. Edward, because no one in this story can learn their damn lesson, was still privy to quite a few secrets. And boy, did Edward love to drink, and Bedeau was only too happy to keep him talking by picking up all those bills at all those fancy hotels. Now, why do I think he was passing on secrets? Remember in our first series how we discussed that Nazi tendency to keep track of everything? Now, that made for a very funny joke, but it doesn't make it any less true. Birds gotta fly, fish gotta swim, nerds gotta keep records. That's just the way it is. And now, it's in these German foreign policy documents housed at Bonn that the dots are connected for us, which I will skip the methodology and simply summarize for you guys.
Thank you.
Bethany's made it aware, or made me aware, that not everybody is a historian and enjoys that as much as I do. So
I'm like, eyes glaze over. I'm like, what?
What? You instantly turn into Pauly Shore when I start talking. And you didn't even smoke first. Right. Now, whether through Badeau or Edward's own lips or his own pen, the Germans were aware of a lot of really top secret shit from the Allies that only Edward would be privy to. And if nothing else I've said yet, guys, convince you that there are a lot of bodies, directly or indirectly, that lay at Edward's feet. What happened in January and February of 1940 certainly will. Now, when Hitler was ready to come at France, he had three choices. North through Belgium, the same way Germany came in World War I. South through the heavily and insanely defended Maginot Line on the French-German border, and then his third option, through the very dense forests of the Ardennes, which the Allies didn't believe was possible if you wanted to move your ass with a big ol' army.
Right.
Hitler thought, worked the first time, let's go again, and decides to goose-step his way into France through Belgium. But just as he was poised to pounce, a Luftwaffe plane carrying the complete battle plans crashes in Belgium. Now, Hitler had no idea if the plans had been intercepted by the Allies. So Hitler stands down some 50, 60 divisions ready to do some country raping and just has to sit on his hands. He continues with the plan, you know, without the knowledge, he can't. If he continues with this plan without the knowledge of what the Allies weren't able to discover from the crash plane, he could walk into a trap.
Yeah, trap. Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, but no worries if you're Nazi Germany, because according to the German archives at Bonn, on February 19th, Hitler receives a cable that reads as followed. Oh, God. Here we go. Listen close, everybody. The Duke of Windsor, that is our dear Edward, has said the Allied War Council devoted an exhaustive discussion at its last meeting to the situation that would arise if Germany invaded Belgium. Reference was made throughout to a German invasion plan said to have been found in an airplane that made a false landing in Belgium. The cable also included detailed information about how Allied forces would repel and respond to a German advance through Belgium. Hitler didn't have to wait anymore. The Allies sat with their eyes on Belgium and along the Maginot Line, and Hitler surprised them all by waltzing through the Ardennes. He knew his original plan was discovered, and rapid attack through the Ardennes would result in an easy invasion of France. Hitler took both the French and the British unawares, and in just 35 days, the German army marched into Paris. Now let's talk about the implications of that cable. Whether Edward informed Badeau, who passed on the information, or Edward just let the embassy at The Hague know it himself, does not matter. Because here's the fact. Hitler might have been stopped then and there. He might have walked right into a trap. The war might have been over in 1940. France might never have suffered what she was about to suffer. Thousands of civilians and soldiers need never have suffered what they were about to suffer. Thousands of people might need never have died. And horribly, I might add. Now, this
talk about a butterfly effect.
Right? Now, this is why I believe 110%, and you can argue and text at me and tweet at me all you want, Edward carries the weight of one hell of a body count on his shoulders. At very least, wittingly or unwittingly, those are the actions of a spy and a traitor.
Yes.
And you know what? I don't believe the Germans made this shit up. They kept separate documents they forged for propaganda purposes from the real deal. And this information was found with the real deal. Now, being a naive adolescent idiot is not an excuse for this action. Hitler brought misery and death that we cannot even imagine today to France in the following years. And Edward, Duke of Windsor, told him how to invade. Now, this to me is absolutely unforgivable and the main causation for our theoretical body count today, guys. This mother told freaking Hitler how, where, and when to invade France to most deadly effect. Now, Bethany, do you agree that this definitely gives Edward a body count now?
Absolutely. Like, I have to admit, like, in the first, you know, episode and the second episode, I kind of felt bad for Edward just because of, like, you know, I've done psychology and I understand that, you know, an adolescent, you know, a brain, if it doesn't get the right things, you know, so I get that. But it's like now he is just making these choices that it's like he literally told Hitler straight up, hey, they're lying about the plane crash. They know you're coming and they know how to defeat you. So use door number three.
Yeah. And everything that happened in France as a result is because of that.
Yes.
I'm not saying that Hitler might not have eventually made his way into France, but there would have been time to evacuate. There would have been time to get people out of, 35 days. He crosses the Ardennes and marches right into Paris.
Mm.
I hate the twat. I hate him so much.
Oh my God.
Like I said, if he wasn't already dead, hope he dies.
Uh-huh.
Man. And let me tell you, I think Edward knew that what he did was wrong. Knew it 100% and did it on purpose because despite holding military office, what he should have done is rejoin his unit and both he and Wallace, you know, evacuate back to Britain. Edward fucks off to his villa in the south of France as the Germans advance after he collects Wallace. Anyone else in the British army would have been seen as a deserter.
So yeah.
Thousands of people are fleeing for their lives or just plain dying because of Edward. This asshole is playing at a villa down in Biarritz.
Wow.
Yeah. So June 21st, French signed the armistice agreement with Germany. Most British people were fleeing France at this time. What does Edward do? Leaves his little villa and heads for Madrid, which was a hotbed of Nazi activity, Nazi spies, and full of Nazi sympathizers. Mm-hmm. Now, doesn't seem like the actions of someone who accidentally made a mistake, does it? So they take up residence at a suite at the Ritz in Madrid, and were welcomed by Franco and the Spanish government. Although officially neutral, the reality was Spain was firmly in Camp Nazi. Spanish society uppity-ups felt the same about the Nazis and fascism as Edward and Wallace did, and therefore they felt very comfortable there.
Mm-hmm.
So while Britain was experiencing one of her darkest hours in the evacuation of Dunkirk, what do you think Edward and Wallace concerned themselves with? Don't worry. They contacted the Gestapo. Now, Paris is firmly under Nazi occupation, but Wallace, like, really wants some of the stuff she left behind, you know, like silver, clothes, jewelry.
Mm-hmm.
And she wants her maid to go and collect it. But don't worry, because the Gestapo was only too happy to provide her maid with papers so that she could get her shit back. So shortly after the evacuation of Dunkirk, Edward and Wallace are contacting Berlin. That is unfreaking real.
Wow.
Right? Now you know why it was such a tough week on my brain. That's just, what? That's all I've been doing. Oh. So Edward no doubt wished to stay in Madrid because, in his idiot head, he felt he could more easily influence the course of the war, or more like his push for peace on Hitler's terms, by staying as close as possible to chat with his besties, the Nazis. It's here that Churchill and Hitler begin their bitch fight to control Edward.
Bitch fight.
What a bitch fight that is, man. Churchill and Hitler going at it. So the Nazis wanted Edward to stay in Spain so that they could easily control and negotiate with him. Churchill told Edward to get his ass home to Britain pronto. Edward begins this stalling game with Churchill, making outrageous demands about receiving influential positions, making sure his wife got her HRH title. Now, Churchill is holding off the Nazis all by himself at this point. He didn't have time for this kind of shit. The thought that Churchill was having to have these conversations while Edward is living in a den of Nazis whom they are at war with, Britain and Churchill, is insane. That's just insane. Especially considering there was a pro-peace party forming in Britain, lobbying for negotiating with Hitler for peace on his terms. And Churchill would be damned if he let them make Edward the figure around which they could rally. And these two twats made no bones about speaking out against the British government and continuing to advocate this bullshit peace process. Hitler was bound and determined to shove up poor Britain's ass. Now, Hitler made it clear to his Spanish ambassador that the Duke and Duchess were to remain in Spain under German control at all costs. And the ambassador was only too happy to report that Edward was literally shouting from the rooftops that he wouldn't return to England unless all his ridiculous terms were met. As Edward sat around in Spain expressing to anyone who cared to listen how against Churchill and the war he was, as well as just, you know, outright saying he was pro-Nazi, our frickin' buddy Von Ribbentrop appears once again. Great. Remember him, Bethany?
Yeah, it's been a while, man.
Oh, we knew that cockroach would show up again sooner or later. Oh, I'm sure he's got like 217 carnations to send Wallace by this time.
Yeah.
So, Von Ribbentrop tells Hitler, for whom he is just as rock hard as ever, the advice that they should just go ahead and outright recruit Edward into the cause now versus wait any longer. German documents of the time show Hitler 100 intended to reinstate Edward as monarch once Britain accepted defeat as a reward for Edward's loyalty. Ugh. Von Ribbentrop even wanted to give the Windsors a shit ton of money to ensure they stayed so that they, quote, could live suitably as a king should. So, Churchill and George VI received cables from their own British ambassador slash spy, basically stating it was no secret that the German purpose was to form an opposition government under Edward using their all-too-real and successful-as-fuck propaganda tactics to sway public opinion. They were very much aware of what a threat Edward and Wallace were becoming. The Germans even thought for sure George VI would just abdicate after attacks eventually began on London. Both the palace and the Germans knew that Edward was playing games with the British government. Churchill ordered Edward out of Madrid under threat of court-martial because, again, remember, he's still in the military, told him to get his ass to Lisbon, Portugal, and from there he was to return home immediately. Now, while Edward and Wallace did go to Lisbon, they ignored the rest. There he chose to stay with a wealthy banker by the name of Ricardo Espirito Santo, who, guess what, Bethany? Big Nazi sympathizer, who was in constant contact with the German embassy in Lisbon. And boy, how convenient was Edward, along with Wallace, having a bomb-ass time there. I mean, Edward would get blind drunk at dinner parties and say some very indiscreet things, which Espirito Santo would promptly report to the German embassy there in Lisbon. 1940 sees the Luftwaffe begin an almost constant raid on British shipping. This gives a now full party mode Edward the idea to really show those true colors of his. Are you ready for this one, Bethany? Or, I mean, are you just asshole quoted out today? Are you ready for this?
No, I want to see your true colors.
Yes. So, Edward tells Espirito Santo and his other Nazi hosts that bombing Britain would so weaken British resolve, he thought it inevitable that Britain would eventually accept Hitler's ultimatum.
Oh, my God.
Now, this information was promptly relayed by Espirito Santo to Berlin via the German ambassador in Lisbon, Heuniggenheiner. The cable went as follows, quote, Edward is waiting for a turn of events favorable to him. He is convinced that if he remained on the throne, war would have been avoided. And he characterizes himself as a firm supporter of a peaceful arrangement with Germany.
Okay, sure.
The Duke believes with certainty that continued heavy bombing will make England ready for peace, end quote.
Oh my God.
Yet another bunch of bodies to lay at Edward's feet.
Wow. Yes, absolutely. Tack on another body count right there.
Right? I mean, suggesting prolonged bombing of his own country and his own countrymen to force
his people
their surrender. Exactly.
Oh my God.
I mean, because bombing means the death of thousands of Englishmen. And then furthermore, it endangers the government by giving credence to that rapidly forming pro-Hitler peace policy movement.
Yeah.
I mean, suggesting prolonged bombing of England would bring the surrender of his own fucking country, of which he was once king. I'm glad you and I have both been rendered speechless by something finally in our life.
Yeah.
That's his own people. And he just tells them, oh yeah, go attack them. Pretty sure that'll weaken it. So let's go on before we get really on our soapbox. Von Ribbentrop immediately began forming a new scheme to get the Windsors back to Spain. He invited them on a hunting trip near the Spanish border. From there, he was to whisk them across the frontier into a castle where they were to remain in secret. Now, once they got there, the plan was for Edward to publicly reject English policy and sever ties permanently with his brother, George VI. Churchill ultimately won the battle. For possession of the Windsors, however, he sent lawyer and friend of Edward's, Walter Monckton, with a warning. And we don't know really what else. Perhaps he blackmailed them with information that would ruin either one or both of their reputations forever. Or maybe he just said, we'll fucking kill the both of you. Yeah. No one knows, but within a matter of hours, Edward had decided not to go with Von Ribbentrop.
Wow.
Yeah.
That it had to have been big to go from, oh, I'm following Hitler, I love Hitler, I love Hitler, to boom, I get a message and it's like, okay, I'm not going to go with you. We can't be friends anymore. My mom says we can't be friends or else.
my government dad said I can't be your friend anymore. Well, not only that. Not only does he change his mind, lickety-split, but Churchill's final offer, after all of that bullshit, is to remove these two treasonous vipers as far away from Europe as he possibly can. And I think maybe put him under the watchful eye of the Americans, as they were now in or headed to our backyard. And we've always been very good at spying. And while we were still neutral, You know, we were helping Britain in any way possible to do so. Now, under the threat of court-martial, Edward and Wallace had no choice but to leave Lisbon. Now, I said they were going to the backyard of America. The offer was for Edward to immediately take up governorship of the Bahamas. So they should be well out of the way, right? But
right.
The Germans hoped to the last that Edward would change his mind. Espirito Santo encouraged Edward not to give up on plans for German negotiated peace. The banker finally revealed who he really worked for, revealing he had it on authority from Berlin to encourage Edward to stay in touch and remain alert. And Edward didn't say, nah, no thanks. In fact, according to personal notes and documents, Edward said paid a very loquacious tribute to Hitler and his desire for negotiated peace and all of its terms. Hitler stated that for, or Hitler, Edward stated that, it's easy to get him mixed up. Edward stated that for various reasons, he was in a position to no longer disobey a direct order and, quote, would have to disclose his, Edward's, intentions too early if he did not go. This suggested that Edward, in coordination with Berlin, had a long-term strategy he intended to stick to even from the Bahamas. I mean, i.e. working on Hitler's, you know, peace terms, American isolationism, etc. Before leaving, Edward made sure to let his new pal Espirito Santo know that he could and would return from the Bahamas at the drop of a hat if developments arose. According to the German documents, there was even an arrangement code word from Berlin to cue Edward it was time to be recalled. Now, Edward fully believed and in fact was counting on his own country losing the war, and he wished to be in the best position possible when this happened. He had no intention of losing touch with the Nazis. On August 1st, 1940, Edward and Wallace depart Lisbon for the Bahamas. And that same day, Hitler issued the order to begin the mass bombing of Britain.
Oh, wow.
Coincidence? I think not.
I think not.
But Hitler didn't know jack shit about Britain because bombing them just seemed to really strengthen their resolve. You know, I mean,
it pissed them off.
It just really pissed them off. Now they had to get up constantly in the middle of the night. Like, it is God on like Donkey Kong, bitch. Like, plus, George VI, a man we know was committed to duty, wasn't going anywhere. And you can bet your ass Churchill was not the kind of man that could be broken. The Windsors, when they should have summarily been executed for treason, in my mind, took up their posts in the Bahamas, which would be most people's dream, right?
Right.
Oh,
I've been there. I would love to go back. Yeah.
Yeah, me too. Especially as the governor. But I guess they were far more into killing a lot of people and sacking countries because these two pricks weren't happy about the Bahamas. Wallace wrote to old Aunt Bessie, I really do wish we could move somewhere inhabited by at very least our own class. Jesus, these two monsters. Like,
wow.
But don't worry. Things picked up for the two when their old friend Alex Venegrin, with instructions from Berlin, showed up, and he and Edward made a couple million dollars off of some illegal currency deals. So that's fun. You know, landed most of their co-conspirators in jail later in the war and after the war, but not Edward and Wallace, Duke and Duchess of Windsor. Never them.
Mm-mm.
Oh, but you know, Edward wasn't done working on behalf of the Germans just yet. Now, America had yet to enter the war, and it was in Hitler and Edward's best interests that we didn't. Edward's last desperate act came on behalf of Berlin, On December 19, 1940, when Edward granted an exclusive interview to a man called Fulton Ousler, an American journalist who just happened to be an intimate friend of President Roosevelt's. Ousler eventually got around to asking Edward in the course of this interview if he believed America should get involved in the war, and Ousler got an answer he could not have imagined. Ousler got around, you know, kind of to talking about rumors that there might be revolution in Germany. Mm-hmm. Edward answered,
oh God,
and
here
I
we go.
Quote, he said there was too much wishful thinking and there would be no revolution in Germany. And it would be a tragic thing for the world if Hitler were overthrown. Hitler, he said, was the right and logical leader of the German people. He said it was unfortunate that I, meaning Ousler, had never met Hitler, and he regarded Hitler as a great man. Quote. And then became apparent to our friend Ousler why he'd been granted such an exclusive interview. Edward had a motive, probably one that was put in his head by Berlin. He was trying to directly depart this information to Roosevelt and thus prevent America entering the war on the Allied side. Edward then said to Ousler, quote, do you suppose that your president would consider intervening as a mediator when, as if the proper time arrives? Tell Mr. Roosevelt that if he will make an offer of intervention for peace, that before anyone in England can oppose it, the Duke of Windsor will instantly issue a statement supporting that. And it will start a revolution in England and force peace, end quote. Now, America's support was instrumental in keeping England afloat. I shouldn't say England, because only he would say England, because he's a twat. Was instrumental in keeping Britain afloat even before we entered the war. In 1940, we supplied everything she needed to continue the good fight. Now, at this time, there wasn't even Soviet support yet. England was still alone. Edward was advocating hanging his own country and his own people out to dry yet again. And if Roosevelt had done such a thing, he, Edward, would basically be sentencing to death his country and his own people with it, just leaving him out to dry.
Yeah, and like people he knows.
Exactly, including his own brother, who's on the throne right now. Or, you know, his, before all this started, friend, Winston Churchill.
Yeah.
Also, he could have, like, his Wallace cake and eat it, too, by being king, I guess. So, here's my favorite part. When Ousler returned to the United States, he immediately went to Roosevelt. Like, he just got on a plane and went straight to Washington from there. Because like, he's just in his own head going,
I gotta tell you about this shit.
I can't believe this shit. I cannot believe what I just heard. Where he, Fulton Ousler, recounts the interview and what it consisted of. Now, Roosevelt, according to Fulton Ousler, responded the following way. And Fulton, he, Roosevelt, said, nothing can surprise me these days. Nothing will seem too fantastic. Why, do you know, he went on earnestly and with a very cunning, cousining smile, that I'm amazed to find some of the greatest people in the British Empire, men of so-called upper classes, men of the very highest rank, secretly want to appease Hitler and stop the war, end quote. Ousler gasped as he realized that agents had been listening and were already perfectly aware of what Edward had said to him. I mean, that's the thing about Edward. He was always too stupid to realize he wasn't a clever spy or influencer. But little matter, because we all know it was for naught. As we know, the Japanese attacked America at Pearl Harbor. And the rest, guys, is literal history. Edward and Wallace died in exile and irrelevance, only returning to Britain in death. Now, these were the contents, everything we just talked about here, of the Windsor file with which we began our story. These were the contents of the German documents discovered by the Allies. They are also the American declassified documents that contain information from the British Secret Service and our own spying. Let's just tell the truth. Now, the truth is that there was probably a lot more, but King George sent a number of his own spies to collect what they could before the Americans or Soviets got their hands on it. They claimed all the German records were forged, but one, the Nazis 110% thought they were going to win the war. So you telling me that they were going to forge documents to make the Windsors look bad, expecting to lose the war? And two, you'll know from episode one, these files were the most accurate, top secret accounts that were for Hitler himself.
Yeah.
They are, ladies and gentlemen, I assure you, accurate. Again, the Nazis were just nerds, and they're not going to keep bad record. They have to do it. They just cannot help themselves. And whereas most documents in Britain are declassified within 30 years or so, documents concerning the royal family stay under lock and key for 100 years. Now, I bet once we peasants are allowed to read them, they will confirm what the Nazis and the Americans seem to agree on when it comes to Edward and Wallace, which brings us around to what we take away from this story, Bethany. We learned in episode two of this series that the monarch does indeed have a lot of soft power, despite only supposedly existing as a symbol of the UK. But wait a minute. I mean, we see Edward and Wallace, how quickly the existence of the royals can threaten freedom and democracy, because they're far from powerless, far from it. Furthermore, the establishment will go to extraordinary lengths to protect them. What kind of message does that send? What sort of figureheads of democracy are they? What we should see, guys, and what we hope our series illuminates, is that these figures have no interest in freedom or equality at all. The Windsors are a perpetuation of a global establishment hierarchy. Mm-hmm. We as people cannot advocate equality and then support people economically and support these people economically and continue essentially to empower them. They are not like us. They exist based on the premise that they are better than us, but they are not. They are actually much worse than us, as our story just showed. And what's more insulting to me, Bethany, is they do nothing to dispel the notion that they do not 100% believe that they are better than us. The people that pay for their existence, despite their being less educated than us and less qualified than the 99% of us, they are a group of wealthy landowners, that 1%. Back room, you know, dealing us into war every so often to increase their wealth. I mean, that's what we just saw in this entire story.
Yeah.
I mean, they're the public face of the 1% global aristocracy. They wear those crowns and make the public pay for their ridiculous weddings to remind us that they're the economic elite at the top and the rest of us exist at the bottom. To provide for them.
We're the soggy French fries at the bottom, soggy cold ones, and they're the crisp, hot out of the fryer.
That's exactly right.
Perfectly, and that's why, salted.
That's why they ride in golden carriages and wear those crowns to remind us of that fact, that there is this group of immovable, non-elected establishment figures that for centuries represented privilege and repression. And what's worse, we all support them. I am not preaching, because you and I have shown throughout the series, we are just as guilty of it.
So,
I mean, we buy it. What, just the other day we were talking about it. So small wonder fascism is creeping its way back into everyday life in the West again. I mean, it's easy to just slide right back into that fascist skin when everywhere you look, you're being told that this small group of people is somehow better than you because they fell out of the right vagina.
Yeah.
It was a great failing in the West following the end of World War II. We educated our populations that fascism was this horrible, easily identified monster, but fascism looks beautiful to the people that are in the value group, like the Windsors, and they do look beautiful, and even in a way to those that are not, because we all want to be a part of it. Think about how we adore those Windsors, no matter what they say or do. Or if they did everything in their power to support fucking Nazis, for example. Like it or not, we still lost that post-war propaganda battle against fascism in large part due to the Windsors. And trust that the Windsors wouldn't be saddened by a rebirth of fascism in their realm. I mean, they're already kings and queens. I mean, then they just don't even have to pretend to care about us. It's beyond imagining. I'm like not advocating we go full 1789 France on their asses, but like I do advocate their removal and a redistribution of their wealth. They didn't earn that, so it's not like I'm advocating socialism. Save your emails. But what can we do, Bethany? I'll tell you one thing we can do. Stop reading about them. It's up to us to let them fade into irrelevancy. Because here's the thing, monarchy has no place in the modern world.
It needs to go.
It needs to go.
Yeah.
I mean, I know people always say, oh, what about tourism? What about tourism? You think people are going to not go see Buckingham Palace if the Queen's not there? Hell no. Hell no. At least then they could see all of what actually belongs to the posterity, then, you know? I mean, if you're worried about tourism, how about we let everybody wander about and watch them like take shits and blow their nose just like the rest of us? Because they're not better than us.
Start reality TV. Now that shit I'd watch.
Right? So what we really hope is that this podcast series kind of opened everyone's eyes as it opened our own eyes. Because let me tell you guys, we were just as guilty. I'll never read another story about any of the twats again. Hate all their guts just because of Edward. Oh, to like what a real travesty in my mind, the existence of a monarchy in 2018 really is. Because at the end of the day, they exist up there for all the rest of us to support them. And that's disgusting. I mean, that's the reality of their legacy. And guess what, Bethany? That concludes our series on the theoretical body count of Edward VIII. What did you think,
Gosh,
man?
what a journey. And to those that have actually like listened to all three episodes, we love you, okay? And thank you for taking this ride with us. I mean, you guys basically took the same ride that I did because Jessica does all this work and she really puts in the time and effort, and I just get to sit back and get to learn about shit and laugh and have a good time. So honestly, this has been such a fun episode. Really, the series has been so fun and
Oh,
enlightening.
guys, and my brain is broken. So, next few weeks are going to be not that body count's ever light, but they're going to be a lot less research intensive than this one. Let me put it that way. Normally, we do our counterculture, but we're running real long on time. So, let's go ahead and do our wrap up, Bethany. If you would like to contact us, you can email us on our website, www.bodycountpod.net, where you can definitely listen, find links to purchase our source material if you would really like to do a deep dive, deeper than what I did. Remember, we just skimmed the surface, so go check it out. You can DM me on Twitter and Instagram with any suggestions that you guys have. We want to know what you want to hear about. Follow the show at Body Count Pod on Instagram and Twitter, and Body Count Pod on Facebook. Please, please tell your friends about us if you like us. Subscribe, rate, review the show. We drop every Wednesday anywhere that you can listen to podcasts, including Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, all of them. Just search Body Space Count. We pop right up first thing on there. You can follow me at Twitter and on Instagram at Jessica Bean Manor. Where do people find you, Bethany?
You can find me on Facebook, Bethany Rose Skelton, S-K-E-L-T-O-N, and on Instagram at BethanyRN24. BethanyRN24.
I have to type it a lot these days. So I know it by heart. Oh, well, thank you so much, guys, for sticking with us. We appreciate you so much. And that does it for this week's episode of Body Count.
Yes.
Join us next week for something hopefully a little more lighthearted, not that it ever is, but less research intensive. Let's put it that way. All right. And I think it's going to be something you guys are really going to love. So from us to you, we love you guys.
Love you.
Bye.
Bye.